My name is Alison Bickford, and you're listening to the Connect Thinking eLearning Academy podcast. This is Episode 5, Online Communities and Networks. Before I begin, a little about Connect Thinking and our academy. Connect Thinking is an e-learning consultancy for Australian organisations. Our online e-learning academy is a place for members from around the world to get practical information, instruction and online support about how to use and implement technologies for learning. Members get individual access to me, the Academy e-coach. Go to www.elearningacademy.com.au for more information. Now let's get on with the show. Last episode we talked about facilitated online learning using webinars, wikis and blogs. Today we'll refer back to the e-learning design framework described in episode 1 and focus on the bottom left quadrant of the framework, which is collaboration and networking tools. If you would like to download a copy of the e-learning framework, go to the show notes on the e-learning academy blog. Collaboration and networking tools provide informal channels that enable social work-based learning and problem-solving to occur. They connect need with expertise and experience. Platforms include wikis, blogs, discussion forums, instant messaging, microblogging, and large corporate installations such as Lotus Connections and Microsoft SharePoint. There are a number of boutique platforms emerging in the market as well, such as Yammer and Yakstar. Online communities and networks can be a good option for learning explorers. These platforms enable employees who can articulate their need to seek solutions by searching online for the right expertise. Refer to Episode 2 Capability Framework for more information. An individual's contribution to a community or network is assessed by peers. Reputation and transparency are the motivators for self-governance in these online environments. So, let's examine the why, how, and tips for implementing collaboration and networking tools as part of a learning strategy. Let's start with why implement collaboration and networking tools. Well, to help answer this question, we'll examine the difference between online communities and online networks. This information comes from work by Nancy White. Online communities are defined by close relationships. The community over time fosters behavioural norms and member expectations, such as appropriate ways to respond to a comment. There is an element of trust, even altruism. Members generally contribute significantly. Often large posts of information, articles, websites and tips. Generally speaking, the community is not scalable because the relationship between members is relatively close and personal. The focus of the community is experience sharing. The platform needs to foster both relationship and the ability to share and respond. Examples of community can include university class online spaces, and organisational communities of practice. When there is a level of trust, online communities can foster meaningful collaboration, debate, decision-making, problem-solving, and innovation. Trust comes from mutual understanding, of give and take. Although mature communities are generally self-organising, at the start, they often require someone to encourage and lead discussion, and model the norms and the intent of the community. Networks, on the other hand, are generally vast and scalable. The focus is just-in-time outcomes and the platform is generally flat and simple. Contribution is generally short and specific. Generally speaking, there is little concern if a member hasn't been heard of for a while. The focus is for the individual to leverage the network, to connect with expertise of immediate need and to filter industry information. Examples include Twitter, Yammer, which is an enterprise form of Twitter, and LinkedIn. Networks are powerful for organisations who want to capitalise on the dispersed experience of their people. Get the platform right and the reward and recognition right, and online networks will help enable emergent knowledge to be dispersed across the organization. So, how to implement collaboration and networking tools? Firstly, always start with a clearly defined purpose based upon a business imperative. Ensure the idea is based on fact and on the needs and desires of a majority of people. Ensure the initiative stays focused on purpose. Try not to dilute the intent with new ideas and functionality, at least during the growth phase of the community or network. Thirdly, use website design usability methods to blueprint the platform and associated functionality. Create a wireframe or mock-up in PowerPoint. Map intended activity flow, headings, and themes, and get feedback from as many end users as possible. Have the platform purposefully built, or purchase a platform with the full knowledge of the design ideals you're compromising or enhancing. Fourthly, test user acceptance frequently throughout the build of the platform. Only action feedback that enhances your purpose. Again, be sure not to complicate the design. Enhancements can always be added in subsequent phases. Fifthly, launch the platform as beta to a test group of users. This signals that you know the platform is likely to require refining. That's just part of the process. And finally, provide a video how-to guide on the homepage to orientate new users to the platform. Include in the video both the purpose and the main functionality. Now finally, tips for implementing collaboration and networking tools. Firstly, do not overpromise the outcome. Momentum for online collaboration and networking takes time, maybe a year or more. A networking platform may take less time for employees to adopt because the effort to be part of the network is usually minimal and the value may be more immediately obvious. Secondly, make a commitment to keep the platform up to date, fresh and interesting. Thirdly, even if it seems nobody is using this space, remember the 99-1 rule, that is, 1% of users will actively contribute, 9 will respond to contributions and 90% will lurk. Now, this doesn't mean lurkers aren't benefiting from the community or the network. It's difficult to measure the degree in which lurkers are actively implementing what they learn from contributors back into the workplace. Embed the platform, or at least the platform feeds, into workflow. Allow users to set up alerts to activity that's important to them. Enable the alerts to be delivered at the frequency of the end user's choosing. Communicate to new and existing employees that the platform exists and how to learn from the platform. It's important to action a change plan to help employees learn how to learn and contribute in these spaces. Monitor activity. Monitor numbers who access the platform, new posts, uploads, and any other quantitative measurements you're able to gain from the platform. And finally, evaluate user opinion of the platform. What's working? What's not? And how things could be improved? Of course, there's a lot more to know about online communities and networks. This has only been an introduction. For more tips and insights, visit www.elearningacademy.com.au. In the next episode of Connect Thinking eLearning Academy podcast, we'll take a look at performance support tools for operational support and expertise development. So, until next time, this is Alison Bickford from Connect Thinking eLearning Academy. Thanks for joining us and hope to see you online.